In this video, I'll walk you through the process of designing a diode ladder filter from scratch. And this type of filter is quite similar to a classic Moog transistor VCF, but implements voltage control using a string of diodes instead. And technically, this video is part 4 of a series I'm doing on filter design in general. But if you already know your way around basic analog filtering and how resonance is created, you should be able to follow along just fine. And if you don't, you can find links to previous episodes in the description. Now, last episode, we began thinking about how we can control a filter's cutoff point with a voltage instead of with our hands. To keep it nice and simple, we decided to start out with a DIY fan favorite, the homemade Vactrol. And while that did work okay, it also felt like a pretty half-baked, messy solution to me. Of course, you could invest some more work and research to iron out the kinks there. But instead of doing that, I rather went ahead and looked at other, arguably more exciting approaches to voltage control, which led me straight to the diode ladder. Now, creating a reasonably simple, but still good-sounding implementation was not too easy, mostly because I had to challenge a few assumptions I've held about diodes and the way they can be used. I think the effort paid off though, because here's the circuit I came up with. A 3-pole, fully resonant diode ladder VCF that does not suffer from the usual, harsh and unpredictable self-oscillation behavior generally associated with this type of filter. Let's take a listen. All sounds in this demo were either made with or processed by this filter. Okay, so how does this work? How exactly do you implement voltage control with diodes? Surely you can't just use them to replace the resistors in our original filter design. Actually, you kinda can. Not without some caveats though, of course, which we'll get to in a minute. But generally, a diode can indeed be used as a quite capable voltage-controlled resistor. Before we get ahead of ourselves though, let's take a step back and recap the absolute basics here. What are diodes exactly? If you look that up online, chances are the first thing you'll read is that a diode is an electrical component that allows the flow of current in only one direction. So essentially, a kind of one-way street for electricity. Now, while this is of course true, it's also an oversimplification. There is one major caveat that you'll probably read about right after that main definition. Diodes only start conducting if the voltage at their input terminal is 0.7 volts larger than the voltage at their output terminal. So the signal here needs to be strong enough to activate the diode. Often, this is modeled in a kind of digital way, as if the diode had clearly defined on and off states. We could also think of those as two resistive states, no resistance, infinite resistance. But of course, this is again way oversimplified. In reality, a diode won't just abruptly turn on as you increase the voltage here from 699 to 700 millivolts. That's because a diode is not a digital device, and therefore does not have those clearly defined on and off states. Instead, it's messy and analog. This means that a diode will never be completely closed, but rather open to varying degrees depending on the input voltage. Think of it like this. Let's say we take a diode and apply 300 millivolts to this side, while connecting that side to ground. Now, if we try measuring the current flowing through the diode, we'll see two things. First, that there actually is a current flowing. And second, that current is quite small. 1.5 microamps in my experiments with a generic 1N4148 diode. This means that it is not blocking the current, it's just strongly resisting it. So if we were to replace the diode with an adequately sized resistor, around 200K, our circuit would behave virtually the same. We'd still have 1.5 microamps flowing from here to here. Which makes it safe to assume that under these specific circumstances, our diode will behave just like a 200K resistor. Note that the emphasis here is on these specific circumstances, because as soon as we in or decrease the voltage up here, the comparison falls apart completely. For the resistor, a doubling in voltage will see a doubling in current. So at 600 millivolts, there'd be 3 microamps flowing. But with our diode, the increase in current will actually be exponential. So at 600 millivolts input voltage, there'll be 580 microamps going through our circuit. That's 386 times more current. And so the comparison to the 200K resistor doesn't work at all anymore. Instead, the diode now behaves more like a 1K resistor. And if we somewhat decrease the voltage to, say, 500 millivolts, a 5K resistor would be the closest match. So essentially, you could think of the diode as a voltage-controlled resistor, where the voltage applied to this terminal directly determines the diode's resistance value, which is exactly what we're looking for. Except there's one major problem. How do we get our oscillation through the diode then? Because by definition, an oscillation is a changing voltage over time. And if we change the voltage here, the diode's effective resistance will change wildly in response. Worse yet, since diodes are one-way streets for current, they will cut off the lower half of a regular audio signal. Because remember, those are centered around 0 volts, and if the voltage here goes negative, the diode will block. To really gauge the problem, let's go all the way back to the first episode and re-examine a single passive low-pass filter stage. The basic working principle there was this. We fed an oscillation into this resistor, which would cause a relatively small current to flow into and out of the capacitor, filling and draining it slowly and thereby rounding the edges of the wave. This is possible because the resistor doesn't care if current flows in this or in that direction. It's going to behave the exact same way in both cases. Also, the amount of current flowing will have no effect on the resistor's resistance value. So we can vary the input voltage as much as we want without affecting the filtering process. Now, if we were to simply replace the resistor with a diode, that'd instantly be a rather glaring issue. The current return path would be blocked, making it impossible for the capacitor to discharge. As a result, it would just be filled up to the brim and then stay that way forever, effectively turning our oscillation into a steady high voltage. Which is rather unfortunate. So we'd need to find an alternate route for our capacitor to be drained through. Now, you might be inclined to ask, why not just use another diode that leads back to the source signal? This way, the high phase of our wave could push through here, while the low phase could drain the cap through here. Problem solved, right? Yes, but only partially. Because in order for this to work as a proper low-pass filter, these diodes' effective resistance values would need to be stable. But as we discovered earlier, Those resistance values are directly tied to the voltages here and here. So as our input signal oscillates, our filter's cutoff point would be moving around wildly, giving us a really mangled output waveform. Okay, but is there any way around this? It seems like the oscillation itself is the problem, because in order to stabilize and control the diode's effective resistances, we'd need to stabilize their in and output voltages. So, game over? Not quite. There's a really nifty trick we can apply here. So imagine we take our input oscillation and we create two copies. One of them will push up using an offset voltage, and the other will drag down by the same margin. Then we'll modify our circuit so that the top diode gets the raised oscillation, while the bottom diode here gets the lowered one. Okay, but how does this help? Well, if you look at the graph here, you'll notice something interesting. While both voltages are still oscillating, the voltage difference between them is staying constant at all times. And since voltages are always just relative, that voltage difference is all that matters. Because in effect, our diodes will see a stable stream of current going through them. You can also call that a bias current. And if this bias current stays constant, the diode's resistance values will stay constant as well. Better yet, those resistance values now depend on the offset voltage we add to and subtract from our oscillation. Because if we reduce that offset, we pull these levels closer together, decreasing the bias current. And this will reduce our diode's effective resistances. Okay, but what does that mean for our filtering capacitor? If we cancel out the oscillation like that, stabilizing the current flowing through here, won't that mean that the ebb and flow, draining and filling of the cap, will cease as well? Luckily for us, it won't. This is because this side of our capacitor is tied to ground, making 0 volts the reference point here. So when both waves are in their high phases, the voltage up here will be more positive in relation to 0 volts than the voltage down here is negative, and vice versa during the low phases. Now, the trick here is that these two diodes practically form a perfect 50% voltage divider, since they'll have nearly identical effective resistances. And as we know, such a 50% voltage divider will cut the voltage between its two reference points in half. You can then imagine this dotted line as the voltage the capacitor sees. It's basically the exact midpoint between the top and bottom voltages. And this midpoint shifts upwards and downwards as the signal oscillates, effectively pushing and pulling current through our diodes into and out of the capacitor. Sounds great, but there are two things to look out for here. First of all, we should be wary of pushing the voltage difference between our two oscillations too much. This is because at some point, our diode's effective resistances would get so low that this path essentially turns into a short circuit. And second, the oscillations themselves need to be kept pretty tiny. The problem is that if the midpoint swing, meaning the voltages here relative to ground, gets too large, it will start messing with the bias current flowing from here to here. This is because any increase in voltage between these two points will pull, or push, an additional current through our diodes. A small midpoint swing will have a rather negligible effect on our bias current. But as you increase that swing, the effect will get pretty severe pretty quickly. This in turn will alter our diode's effective resistances noticeably, resulting in an unstable cutoff point and a distorted output. Okay, so with these things in mind, we would be able to build a basic single pole low pass filter. But what if we'd like to have a 2 or a 3 pole version? Luckily for us, adding poles requires little to no extra effort. It's as simple as chaining multiple stages like this. There is one small caveat though. The total number of stages needs to be odd. This has two reasons which are closely interlinked. The first one is not crucial, but it's really a convenience type thing. So if the total number of stages is odd, all the diodes taken together will form a big, evenly stepped voltage divider that has a single central node. And at that node, the voltage will always oscillate around 0 volts, which will make it easy for us to grab the signal because we won't have to remove an offset voltage. The second reason is somewhat more critical though. So imagine we design a diode ladder filter with two stages. Then first, we'll have to decide from which node we'll pick up our output signal. Let's assume we choose this one. Now we'll apply our raised square wave oscillation up here, and our lowered counterpart down here. During the high phases, this upper capacitor will be filled up first, simply because it's closer to the source. This means that until that cap is completely full, this second cap will only get the scraps that spill over, effectively delaying the charging process and thereby the rise in voltage at this point. Now, so far, this is actually what we expect and want from a two-pole filter. The actual problem arises during the oscillation's low phase, because during that low phase, now our chosen capacitor is closer to the drain, which means that it now has priority and will get drained faster than the other cap. This introduces a strong asymmetry into our output, because the falling edge will be steeper than the rising edge. What can we do about it? Well, like I said before, we just need to make sure that the total number of stages is odd, because then the capacitor at the middle node will always be as far from the source as it is from the drain, giving us a symmetrical, undistorted output wave. Which is also why a three-pole diode ladder filter consists of five individual stages. You can think of it like this, though it is an oversimplification. All the rising edges of our input wave will be filtered by these three stages, while all the falling edges will be filtered by these. Now, since there are no buffers between the stages, this is not entirely true, because all of them influence each other at any point in time. But as an approximation, I think we can go with this kind of model. There is one final thing we need to talk about. You'll notice that I haven't drawn in any values for our capacitors here yet. So we'll have to decide on those before we can proceed. In my experiments, I fared best with 1 nanofarad caps, since those gave me a decent range, going from killing all frequencies to letting through up to 20 kilohertz. Feel free to experiment with different values though. Okay, so now that we know how to properly set up our diode ladder, we need to think about how we'll feed it our oscillation. Thankfully, doing that is pretty straightforward, even though this schematic might look a bit daunting at first. The basic idea is this. Over here, we have our input signal, and below that, we have a potentiometer set up as a variable voltage divider. This will be our control voltage source for now, so that we can test every voltage between plus and minus 12 volts. So first of all, we'll send our input oscillation through AC coupling to eliminate any offset voltage and center it around 0 volts. Then we'll shrink it down quite intensely using a 33k 330 ohms voltage divider. I'm expecting the input signal to be 10 volts peak to peak, so this will give us a 100 millivolts peak to peak result. Because remember, in order to not mess with the bias current too much later, our oscillation needs to be very small. Now, you could get away with a bit more power, but I am playing it fairly safe here. Feel free to experiment with stronger input signals, though. In order to make sure that the input signal is not loaded down by the rest of our circuit, we'll buffer it with a simple non-inverting op-amp setup. Next, we'll need to create 2 separate copies of our now scaled-down oscillation and push one of them up and the other one down using the control voltage. Now, there's a couple ways to do this, but I'm using op-amps since they're so easy to handle. Let's start with the lowered oscillation. While we could do this the intuitive way, which for me would mean first inverting the offset voltage, then mixing it into our oscillation, and finally buffering the result, this would use up 2 op-amps for something that you can essentially do with 1. The trick here is to use 1 inverting op-amp buffer for both purposes at once. If you need a refresher on how the inverting op-amp configuration works, I've put a link to a thorough explanation I did recently in the description. But the basic gist of it is this. You connect your input signals through resistors with the inverting input, while grounding the non-inverting input. Then you add another resistor from inverting input to output. Now, if the resistors are all of the same value, like they are here, if you forget about this one for a second, you get the inverted sum of your inputs at the op-amp's output. So if we set our offset to, say, 1 volt, the sum of that offset and our small oscillation would be a signal that's swinging from 1.05 to 0.95 volts. Invert that, and we've successfully pushed down our oscillation by the given offset. Heads up though, as a side effect, we also inverted the oscillation itself. So we'll need to make sure that we invert the raised oscillation as well. Which is why we'll have to set up our second op-amp in the inverting configuration also. But now the question is, how do we push our signal up instead of dragging it down? The solution might confuse you at first, because normally when we set up an inverting amplifier, we connect the op-amp's non-inverting input straight to ground. But in this particular case, we feed that input exactly half of our offset voltage, hence the 50% voltage divider here. Why? Well, the basic idea is that we want to push the op-amp's point of reference upwards. When the non-inverting input is connected to 0 volts, the amplifier will invert the signal at the inverting input in relation to those 0 volts, which is why an input of 50 millivolts up here will see an output of minus 50 millivolts over here. 0 volts is basically the mid-axis across which we're jumping. By pushing that mid-axis up, we pretty much recalibrate the output. So let's assume we send in 500 millivolts here. Now, if we take our 50 millivolts and we jump that new mid-axis, we get 950 millivolts as an output. And for minus 50 millivolts, we'd get 1.05. So we've essentially inverted our oscillation while also pushing it up by our example offset, namely 1 volt, through applying half that offset to the non-inverting input, which is exactly what we're doing here with our 50% voltage divider. Okay, so we've almost made our way through this maze of a schematic. There's just one small curiosity left, the 2K resistor at the op-amp's outputs. These are not exactly necessary, they don't alter the voltage levels at these two points. But they are a protective measure. Because as I explained before, if we push our diode ladder too far, meaning that we increase the voltage difference between these two points by too much, the diode's resistances will drop so low that we've essentially created a short circuit here. The 2K resistors will then ensure that we don't kill our op-amps in the process, and they do that by limiting the maximum amount of current flowing. Okay, let's finally start building. First of all, we'll verify that creating those two offset copies works as intended. So I'll first prepare our input signal by routing it through the standard 1 microfarad 200K high pass. Then I'll shrink it down using a 33K 330 ohms voltage divider and buffer that by setting up a TL074 right here. Next, I'll add our offset potentiometer, configuring it as a variable voltage divider. With that done, I'll set up another TL074 over here. This is for spacing reasons. It'll make sense later. Now, this op-amp will be creating our lowered oscillation. For that, we'll simply have to connect the non-inverting input to ground while sending the source signal and the offset to the inverting input through 33K resistors. Finally, we'll connect that inverting input to the output through a 33K plus that protective 2K resistor. For the raised oscillation, we'll first send our source signal to this other op-amp's inverting input through a 33K resistor. Then the non-inverting input gets the divided down offset. Again, connecting inverting input and output with the 33-2K pair, and we should be ready to test this. So I've connected each op-amp to separate channels on my oscilloscope. And right now, the offset is set to 0 volts, which is why we're seeing an oscillation salad here. Which is also quite noisy, because it's so low volume. But watch what happens as I increase that offset. The lines drift apart, and we get our lowered and our raised copies as expected. Okay, so time to set up the star of the show. Starting at the raising op-amp, I'll string 5 diodes across the breadboard, with some space between them. The last one then loops back to the other op-amp. At every diode intersection, I'll add a 1 nF capacitor, with the other leg connected to ground. And that's it. Now we should be able to pick up a filtered signal from the central capacitor here. And there's a problem right away. Since the oscillation is so quiet, my oscilloscope has trouble tracing it through the noise. Because remember, we shrunk it down to just 100 millivolts peak to peak before sending it through our diode ladder. So if we really want to see what's going on, and also if we want to listen to it, we need to amplify the signal quite a lot. Now, doing that is really straightforward. If you wanted to do it the super easy way, you could just set up a non-inverting amplifier with huge gain and be done with it. But we should go the extra mile here and implement a slightly more complex solution. As you can see, I chose to first buffer the diode ladder's output before then blowing it up using an inverting amplifier. This has two reasons. First of all, by inverting the output, we make sure that it's in phase with the input. Because remember, while making our two offset copies, we inverted both of them. So this pretty much reverses that. But in order to not load the lattice output, we need the buffer here. And second, we will also need that buffer to implement the resonance path later. For setting the amplifier's gain, I'm picking rather conservative resistor values. These will get our signal up to around 4 volts peak to peak and leave us with plenty of headroom for the aforementioned resonance. And as usual, I'll add AC coupling to the output in order to make sure that it's properly centered around 0 volts. Okay, so I'll set up this op amp as a buffer and then feed it our diode ladder's output. Because we'll be using the op amp next to it for the resonance later, I'll use one of the op amps over here as our high gain inverting amplifier. And now we should be able to properly look at and listen to our output signal. And yeah, now we can make out the input square much more clearly. So far, so good. Let's see what happens if I mess with the control voltage. Okay, so turning it down will indeed reduce our filter's cutoff, even though the usable range is really small and therefore the knob is really finicky. Also, if I turn it up, we start seeing these weird glitches before the signal drops out completely. This happens because we are pushing the bias current going through our diodes so much that their resistance values drop dramatically, which causes all kinds of undesirable effects, essentially killing the oscillation at our filter's output. What can we do about those two problems? The answer is thankfully quite simple. We need to properly scale and also set an upper limit for our incoming CV. And the way we'll do that is somewhat crude, but effective. First, we'll use a box standard 10% voltage divider to get our maximum of 12 volts here down to just 1.2. In my experiments, this is right below the threshold where the glitches start appearing. Also, doing this will dramatically widen our potentiometer's usable range, since it is now much better aligned with those of the filtering diodes. Speaking of diodes, what's up with these three down here? Well, if we had only a single offset knob, those wouldn't be necessary. But since we'd also like to use an additional external CV signal, we need to make sure that the voltage here does not rise above 1.2 volts. Because now imagine that we set our offset to 12 volts and also send in a big voltage through this input. This would cause the voltage here to be raised beyond that 1.2 volts line, getting us into glitch territory again. But by adding in three diodes to ground, we can prevent this scenario. Because as we now know, those diodes will act like voltage controlled resistors. So as long as the voltage at this point is relatively low, our diodes will only let a tiny amount of current flow through them, which won't affect the voltage very much. But as soon as we get close to the 1.2 volts threshold, their combined resistance values will drop very quickly, pulling the voltage here down again. So with this, we're essentially clipping our CV. And to top all that off, we're going to buffer the whole thing with a simple non-inverting op-amp setup. This is necessary because the voltage here is quite volatile and susceptible to loading effects. To try this out, I'll first configure one of the op-amps here as a buffer. Then I'll use two 100k resistors to send in our offset plus the external input. Finally, I'll add in the 10k resistor and the three diodes to ground, connect the buffer's output to the rest of our circuit, and we're good to go. So let's first test the potentiometer sweep without any external CV plugged in. As you can hear, we're actually getting a really decent smooth response. This is because our diode ladder is reacting in an exponential way to a linear increase in control voltage. And since our ears basically work on a logarithmic scale, this sounds smooth and linear to us. Next, I'll plug in an LFO as an external CV source. Thankfully, the clipping diodes are doing their job, and we don't get any unexpected glitching behavior. Great, but we have one final important thing to implement. Resonance. Now, if you've watched the second episode in this series, where I go over that topic in detail, you'll probably recognize this circuit. We're basically just taking our filter's buffered output, routing it through a variable voltage divider, and then amplifying it through this op-amp. Finally, we're feeding the resulting signal, which can now be varied from silent to pretty intense, back into our filter through these two capacitors. Now, you might ask, why feed it into both of those? Well, this is simply because of the way we constructed our diode ladder. Remember that we are applying our input oscillation up here as well as down here in order to keep the bias current going through the diode stable. So if we only send in our feedback up here, we would create an asymmetry that would mess with the filter's operation. But sending it into both caps will allow us to preserve that symmetry because the top and bottom oscillations will be identical again, save for the offset. Now, before we try this, let's talk about the op-amp's configuration. Compared to the way we set it up in the resonance episode, we really cut down on diodes here. What's up with that? Well, this is because those diodes now serve the opposite purpose. In that previous episode, we used strings of three diodes in the feedback path to clip and thereby distort the resonance, giving us that typical dirty MS-20 style sound. But here, we use just a pair of single diodes in order to clean up and control the resonance. How does this work? Simple. Remember how we said that our diode ladder will react exponentially to any linear increase in input voltage? Well, now imagine that we remove these two diodes. This means that our feedback amplifier will operate in a strictly linear manner, so that any and all increases in volume at the filter's output will get amplified by a fixed factor and then fed back into the diode ladder. You can probably see how that will spiral out of control quite quickly. Because there is nothing keeping the amount of feedback in check, it will begin to ramp up exponentially until the oscillations over here get so strong that they overpower the bias current and make our diode ladder shut down completely. Don't believe me? Let's try it out. Good thing I reserved this op-amp over here for the resonance earlier. So all we need to do is take the ladder's buffered output, feed it into a 100k potentiometer set up as a variable voltage divider, hook that up to our op-amp, and then set its gain with a 10k 2k7 resistor combination. Finally, I'll send that op-amp's output to the first and last filtering caps. Okay, I have the resonance completely turned down at the moment, and so our filter is still working. But watch what happens as I turn it up. Like I said, the output just dies instantly. So let's do something about that. This is where the diodes come into play. If we put them into the op-amp's feedback path like this, they will essentially counteract the diode ladder's exponential behavior. Because as long as the signal coming in through here is relatively quiet, these diodes' effective resistances will be really high, which means that the op-amp's gain is unaffected. But as soon as our feedback loop begins its upward spiral, those diodes will in response begin conducting more and more, lowering the gain quite drastically. So in effect, we're basically straightening out the exponential curve here, which will give us a silky smooth, clean resonance. Applying this idea is thankfully as easy as inserting two diodes right here. And yeah, Now it's working properly. Here it is playing the sequence from before. Now, the cool thing about having clean sounding resonance is that you can use the filter to make quite nice sounding drums. So here's a simple kick drum. All things considered, I'm pretty happy with how this design turned out. Now, of course, it's still lacking the high pass option that I've already been neglecting in the past. I'll have to do a follow-up video on that soon. In the meantime, be sure to check out my Patreon. I've recently launched a community Discord server where patrons can ask for help and share ideas. There's a link in the description. Anyways, thanks for watching, and until next time, see ya!